shock is a condition resulting from inadequate oxygen supply to the body tissues and major organs, and will accompany any injury, condition, or illness to some degree. Shock may also be caused by a loss of body fluids, major or multiple fractures, severe burns, damage to the heart, standing still for too long, a sudden emotional shock, infection, anaphylaxis, fear, pain, or an unpleasant experience. Signs and symptoms may include dizziness, anxiety, thirst, nausea, collapse, rapid breathing, vomiting, or decreased level of consciousness. Follow the DRS ABCD action plan and treat the cause of shock if possible. If the casualty is conscious, lay them down flat, comfort them, keep them warm, and provide reassurance. The Australian Resuscitation Council guidelines has recommended to remove elevating the legs for shock from first aid practice, as research has shown there is no evidence to support the benefits. Do not give the casualty anything to eat or drink. If unconscious and breathing, place the person on their side in the recovery position and repeatedly recheck condition for any change. Most external bleeding will be minor and usually stops within 10 minutes through blood clotting. For minor bleeding, apply direct pressure to the wound until bleeding stops. Clean if necessary and cover with a clean or sterile dressing. Sometimes, though, bleeding may be life-threatening if the damaged blood vessel is large or the blood is under too much pressure for effective clotting to occur. Examine the wound quickly for embedded objects. Once you are sure there is no object in the wound, apply direct pressure with hands and bandage to stop the bleeding, restrict movement, and ideally immobilise the part. A significant amount of bleeding may occur with wounds to the head and face. This bleeding is usually controlled with direct pressure, but care must be taken to avoid pressing onto a possible fractured skull. Assess the surrounding area. If a depression, sponginess, or bone fragments are felt under the skin, do not apply pressure directly onto the wound. Attempt to control the bleeding with pressure around the wound using a donut bandage. Once a fracture of the skull has been eliminated, direct hand pressure may need to be maintained because of the difficulty of bandaging the head firmly enough to control the bleeding. To treat a person with a nosebleed, sit the casualty down with the head slightly forward, not back. The nostrils are pinched over the soft, fleshy area at the end of the nose bone for at least 10 minutes. Instruct the casualty to spit out any blood, breathe through the mouth, and not to blow the nose. If bleeding continues, reapply pressure for a further 10 minutes. If bleeding persists, seek medical attention. In the event of an amputation, firstly manage the stump by applying direct pressure and elevation, then provide rest and reassurance to the casualty. Manage the casualty for shock, then care for the amputated body part. Retrieve the body part and place it in a sealed plastic bag. Do not wash the body part, even if dirty. Label with name of the casualty and the time of the amputation. Place the sealed plastic bag into a container of water and ice and transport with the casualty. When a foreign object such as a knife, glass, branch or stick is embedded in a wound, do not remove the object as it may be acting as a plug. Apply pressure around the object using a donut bandage. Penetrating, embedded or puncture wounds and any bites have a substantial risk of becoming infected, and medical treatment needs to be sought.